This is WGRZ TV2 Buffalo. From the Center for News in Western New York, this is News Center 2.
Good evening, I'm Beverly Armstrong. Mike has the night off. A Cheektowaga apartment complex turned into a deadly inferno tonight and killed two people. Unconfirmed reports say a man and a woman died in the blaze at 4 Glenwood Court. At least two firefighters have been taken to the Erie County Medical Center for treatment. The Cleveland Hill Fire Chief describes the scene when they first arrived.
Some people trapped, and we've contained the fire, and that's all I know right now. I have no further details.
Any injuries?
Investigators are still on the scene, searching for the cause. A motorcyclist killed in the town of Pembroke overnight was a witness in the murder of Teresa Surianello in May. The body of 30-year-old Carl Schimelli was found near his bike on Slicker Road. He was considered a key witness, but it's too early to tell what effect his death will have on the case. Surianello was shot to death during a robbery involving cocaine. A motorcyclist was critically injured tonight when he sideswiped a car at the corner of East Ferry and Moselle Streets. 32-year-old Albert Price of Cambridge Street was taken to the Erie County Medical Center. Police say no charges are expected. Authorities in Niagara Falls say they've spotted a body in the whirlpool. It's believed to be that of a 23-year-old man reported missing in the lower Niagara River yesterday. Parks police say there will be no attempt to recover the body until it gets a little closer to shore. The body of a 16-year-old Walter Parrott of South Street was pulled from the Buffalo River early this morning. Authorities say he may have been drinking with friends at the foot of Michigan Avenue before going for a swim. The cause of death has not been listed. Statistics show crime in the city of Buffalo has decreased by more than 10% and arrests have increased. They've risen as much as 49% in some precincts over last year. Police Commissioner Myers attributes the hike to more manpower and increased community awareness. Crime figures from the FBI show there are three times as many serial killings here in the U.S. than in the rest of the world. At least 20 serial killings were reported in the U.S. in the past 20 years, compared to 40 in the rest of the world. Millionaire kidnapping victim Edith Rosenkranz says she had faith she would make it through her ordeal. She did. Now police have three suspects in custody.
Kidnappers released Edith Rosenkranz late last night. She spent a terrifying 2 days in captivity before her husband paid the ransom, reportedly $1 million.
He told me that he was going to let me out and that I should stand still at that place for 5 minutes. And then my husband would come and pick me up. And he opened the door of the van and said, don't look back.
150 District of Columbia police and FBI agents scoured the Capitol for nearly 48 hours before Mrs. Rosenkranz was freed, the kidnappers arrested, and the ransom recovered. The Rosenkranzes live in Mexico City. He's founder of the Syntex Pharmaceutical Company. They were in Washington for a bridge tournament at the sprawling Sheraton Hotel. One of the alleged kidnappers, Glenn Wright, played in the tournament and allegedly masterminded the plan. A man who knew him said he had money troubles.
The motive was solely the fact that financially, Glenn was in very bad shape and I'm sure just wanted some money.
A tournament official agreed.
What do you think his motive was?
Money. Money.
This afternoon, Mrs. Rosenkranz told more about her ordeal.
They said that, that they might kill me or that they might bring me back and... there was a person who said that no matter what's going to happen, I'm going to see to it that you will be back.
I had a tremendous faith in a happy outcome. I had a faith in God. Above all, I had a faith and a great trust in my wife that she will be able to go through this plight.
Police apparently had a clue this was done by someone at the tournament. The hotel and its grounds were the focus of their investigation for nearly all of the 2 days Mrs. Rosenkranz was held captive. Steve Hurst, NBC News, Washington.
Vandals removed the right arm of Copenhagen's beloved Little Mermaid statue. It's the second time the statue of a Hans Christian Andersen character has been vandalized in the last 20 years. In 1964, the head was removed. The mermaid, perched on a rock at the mouth of the Copenhagen harbor, has become a familiar symbol of the Danish capital. Back home, the Democratic vice presidential nominee tried to carry on home life as usual today. Geraldine Ferraro attended church with her family, where the congregation clapped and waved as they went in for mass. Meanwhile, Walter Mondale finally got in some fishing today. He's on a three-week recess before his serious campaigning begins.
The self-proclaimed greatest fisherman ever to run for president finally got down to some serious fishing today in the remote northeast corner of Minnesota, but not before answering one more round of questions from reporters who are not on vacation.
How many more news conferences? Somehow I'm not in the spirit of this news conference.
The question was on his reaction to a new Gallup poll showing the Mondale-Ferraro team leading the Reagan-Bush ticket by 2 points right after the Democratic convention.
I think the campaign starts out probably dead even, but it's going to be tough. We'll win it.
Yesterday, Mondale and his sons went fishing within an hour of their arrival at Gunflint Lake.
We have a perfect record. Zero.
Then it was off to the day's serious work with fishing buddy Harry Munger. But of course, a flotilla of photographers had to go along too to record the action. There was a bit of a scramble as four boatloads of lenses did a little angling of their own, trying for the perfect shot of the greatest fisherman ever to run for president, patiently casting and reeling in, while the sound of many motors drove every fish in the neighborhood away. When that was done, Mondale roared off toward a secret spot where he says there are fish, finally alone for the first time since the convention, to relax the way he likes best. Steve Delaney, NBC News, with the Mondale campaign in northern Minnesota.
Still to come from the news center, the governor cracks down on illegal chop shops, and the county legislature gets ready for their big vote.
Heard about Goodyear's sale on steel? This is Goodyear's custom poly steel radial. I put hundreds of them on at the regular price, but these go on at sale prices. Custom poly steel. Goodyear's great steel belted radial. On sale. How about putting a set on your car?
Get a good deal on poly steel at Goodyear.
But come in now, because it won't be long till I go back to putting them on at the regular price.
Drive in now and save at Goodyear.
History could be made at the United Auto Workers talks that began this week between the nation's top two automakers. Analysts predict this may be the most important round in the history of the industry. The General Motors and Ford companies will meet with the president of the UAW and his bargaining teams. The union gave up concessions worth $4 billion in the last major contract talks back in 1982. Governor Cuomo is cracking down on people who illegally strip cars for parts. The new bill sets tougher penalties for offenders and is directly aimed at so-called chop shops. The new law will go into effect November 1st. Erie County's budget will be finalized tomorrow as the legislature holds its final session of the summer. Legislator Len Lenihan told NewsCenter 2's Rana Shore he's certain the lawmakers will vote to override Rutkowski's veto of the Erie Community College budget. Meanwhile, one program that stands to be cut is the Children's Psychiatric Clinic at ECMC. The workers are fighting to keep the clinic open because they say the children who are treated here from poor families have nowhere else to turn.
There's nowhere else they would get this kind of get service in Buffalo because of the long waiting lists that exist at other agencies and clinics that serve the same population.
Legislators to change their minds. Up next from the news center, the sunshine continues. Arnie is up next with his forecast.
Old Milwaukee books mean something great to these guys. The shotgun means white water at its best. And old Milwaukee means a great beer. Cold, crisp, old Milwaukee beer. And smooth, golden, old Milwaukee light.
And old Milwaukee.
And old Milwaukee light.
Taste as great as their name.
You know, guys, it doesn't get any better than this. If you've been playing around in the money game, there is something you should know. When you invest in U.S. savings bonds, you're investing in the newest game in town. Savings bonds now have a variable interest rate, so you share in the higher returns of the money market. Your money can grow and grow. A variable rate with no limit on how much you can earn. That could mean a big score. A variable rate for as little as $25. And you can't lose, even if rates decline. Because savings bonds have a guaranteed minimum. That's opportunity without risk. So tilt the future in your favor. Take stock in America. Buy bonds.
Ponderosa breakfast.
At some fast food places, you get breakfast in a box. But now at Ponderosa, you get all you can eat from the world's biggest, best breakfast buffet. Not just bacon and eggs, but all kinds of great things you just don't find everywhere, including the biggest selection of fresh fruit. Your choice. This or the world's biggest, best breakfast buffet.
The world's biggest, best breakfast buffet.
The windmill's down, and fixing it won't wait for the weather. And when you've got it going again, you head for the mountains. Push. Head for the beer that goes down smooth as a mountain stream. Busch. Brewed the natural way for a taste as smooth as its name. Busch.
Head for Busch Beer.
Head for the mountains.
You're inside the American Airlines maintenance base where professionals like Richard McCormick run thousands of checks on our planes inside and out as part of our comprehensive maintenance program. At American, we spend over $1 million a day keeping our planes up to the highest standards. But there are some things you just can't put a price on.
We're American Airlines, doing what we do best.
I do a lot of traveling, and I found the answer to getting to the airport, my own car. And I let Thrifty Air Park look after it for me.
Their staff is friendly, efficient, and courteous. They park your car, whisk it to the airport to catch your flight, and they even supply the quarter for the phone on your return. Quick, efficient pickup, and Thrifty is thrifty.
The next time you fly, ask your travel agent about Thrifty Air Park. Tell him Rick Campbell recommended it. You'll be glad you did.
$15 million is at stake in next Wednesday's lotto drawing. No one won last night, so the jackpot got bigger. Lottery director John Quinn says bettors should get out early because the lines for tickets are bound to be long. And Arnie says those lines are bound to be hot again.
Hot, muggy, the whole works again.
Oh my goodness, get out before noon.
Oh yeah, it was a pretty good weekend overall, wouldn't you say?
I'd
at least
say so.
We didn't have a lot of rain to speak of, but we may deal with a thunderstorm, a little bit of rain activity later in the day tomorrow. That will be about the only cooling relief we can speak of in this forecast. Let's check outside right now. We have a temperature reading 75 degrees, 24 Celsius, relative humidity 61%, still kind of muggy out there. 30-13, the barometer, currently falling south-southwesterly breezes at about 7 miles per hour. Weather log for today, we had a high of 88, very muggy degrees today, 61 the morning low, 80 and 61 the norms, and the record high, 94 set back in 1953, and 14 years ago, the record low, 50 degrees back in 1970. No precipitation to speak of, and our satellite picture gives no hint of any real precipitation around our region right now. There is a little bit of cloudiness on top of western New York, extending from New England down through the Great Lakes. That is just high cloudiness, nothing in terms of precipitation to worry about from those clouds. The more significant cloudiness with more rainfall associated with them over across the Rockies right now, scattered showers and thunderstorms throughout that region. And that shows off very well with some of that shower and thunderstorm activity on radar. But dry as a bone, as you can see, from about the northeast right across the Great Lakes, a lonely shower trying to work its way into Michigan. And that is the leading edge of cooler air, which will try and work in our direction tomorrow. But it doesn't look like there will be too much in the way of rain activity with that front. We'll talk about that in the forecast coming up. Right now, we're under that influence of that southwesterly breeze, which is yanking up all that heat, humidity that's been just salvaging itself over in the midsection of the nation over the course of the past week or so. A piece of that warm air broke off and sat on top of us this weekend, and we'll have to deal and cope with more of that hot weather again during the day tomorrow. But there is drier air that's trying ever so hard to work in our direction. The boundary line between those two air masses, a frontal zone that's working its way into the western Great Lakes right now. Now, that frontal zone during the early part of the day tomorrow will work its way into the western Great Lakes. No problem early in the day. We'll have at least some hazy sunshine to start the day. Those temperatures once again will be heating up well into the 80s, just as they did here on Sunday, and humidity levels will be kind of high. They'll be a little bit on the uncomfortable side throughout the entire day ahead. But later in the afternoon, that frontal system will make its drive toward us. Consequently, the clouds will probably build later in the afternoon into the evening hours. There may be an afternoon or evening shower or thunderstorm in one or two places. The whole day will not be bad at all. There will be plenty of hazy sunshine to enjoy. That shower threat, though, will continue into the early part of tomorrow night. And it looks like by Tuesday, we'll watch that frontal system as it sags just to our south. Now, the dry air behind it is going to be retarded right well up into Canada. So we'll keep a little bit of residual moisture behind that front. And Tuesday, however, we'll see just sun and clouds, and I cannot rule out a stray shower during the day. So we wrap it up in our forecast. First, we'll take a look at those lows tonight. Lower 70s right now, and they'll be dropping into the upper 60s tonight. Patchy haze and fog around, partly cloudy skies. Tomorrow, pretty nice day overall. Hazy sunshine, and then the clouds coming in later in the afternoon with that afternoon or evening shower or thunderstorm threat. 85 to 90, so another warm, muggy one coming up. Wind southwesterly at 10 miles per hour. The shower thunderstorm threat continues into tomorrow night, and then on Tuesday, sunshine mixing with clouds. Temperatures at least cooling off into the lower 80s. So another warm, muggy one coming up to deal with tomorrow.
Not quite comfortable, but we'll wait. We'll take it, Ernie.
Okay.
Thanks a lot. Just ahead from the news center, a Spaniard takes the British Open, and Buffalo's only soccer team continues to roll along. Mike is next with details.
Young Olympic hopefuls, dreaming of the gold, the 10,000-meter gold. Meanwhile, he trains and adds Z-Bec to his diet. Z-Bec with zinc, because as he sweats, he loses zinc, a mineral even more precious than gold for John's good health.
Z-Bec helps my diet replace my body's zinc and has vitamins that help convert food into energy.
May your dream come true. Go, John, go! Z-Bec, official sponsor of the 1984 U.S. Olympic team.
Inside the American Airlines maintenance base, where professionals like Richard McCormick run thousands of checks on our planes inside and out as part of our comprehensive maintenance program. At American, we spend over $1 million a day keeping our planes up to the highest standards, but there are some things you just can't put a price on.
We're American Airlines, doing what we do best.
The following AMCO message is for everyone with transmission worries.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Over half the people who come to AMCO needed only minor repairs or service. Worried about your transmission?
Oh, no.
Come into AMCO. AAMCO.
There's an AMCO near you in Amherst, Buffalo, West Seneca, Niagara Falls, and Scarborough, Ontario. AMCO Transmissions.
The Olympic torch continues its journey through Southern California on its way to Los Angeles, to the site of the Olympics. The torch was brought into Burbank, Glendale, and Pasadena, where 68-year-old Lenora Nicholson Woodward proudly carried the Olympic symbol. USFL Wranglers football coach George Allen also had a shot at carrying the torch. Big day today. British Open.
for the Buffalo Storm first. You know, ever since the Stallions called the quits, the Storm has been doing pretty well. I wonder if there's anything going on there, Bev, but make it five in a row for the Buffalo Storm anyway. Tonight, their second straight shutout win over Rochester, 1-0 before over 1,200 out at All-High Stadium. Now, the only goal coming right here 18 minutes into the second half. Randy Pikusinski taking a nice pass from Niels Gulberg. That made it 1-0 for Randy, his third goal of the season. And talk about great goaltending. Buffalo's Peter Grillo with his fourth shutout of the season tonight, stopping all eight Rochester shots. The Storm now 9-7, still in first place, 10 points ahead of second place New York in the Northern Division of the United Soccer League. Next start for the Storm Friday night in Dallas. To golf, a classic ending to today's final round of the British Open. Two golfers going head-to-head right to the final hole.
Seve Ballesteros trailed Tom Watson by one shot until here at the sixth hole, the birdie gives him a share of the lead. Third round leader Ian Baker Finch had all kinds of problems. Here with a double bogey at six, he went on to cart a 79, finishing eight shots back. To the 13th, Tom Watson still tied with Ballesteros. This birdie putt gives him the outright lead, but just for the moment, because on the 14th, Ballesteros, with a chance at birdie, rams it home to go 11 under par. They were tied once more. Here come the two biggest shots of the tournament. Watson on the 17th. He was still tied with Ballesteros for the lead. He tried to get this approach within birdie territory instead of going for par, and he paid dearly. His ball ended up next to a stone wall. Watson would make bogey. So Ballesteros on the 18th had a one-shot lead, and this birdie putt would put it away. Ballesteros just has enough. Seve Ballesteros wins the British Open Championship with a tournament record total of 12 under par. This is Scott Clark reporting for NBC News.
You think Seve ain't happy? So here's the board. Seve by two shots over Watson and Bernard Langer. Fred Couples and Lenny Watkins, both five off the pace. Other scores, Greg Norman with a good round today. Yesterday's co-leader, Ian Baker Finch, with a 79. That put him well back. And Jack Nicklaus wound up at 288 after a 72 today. It's all systems go for the Bills. Tomorrow, the Vets come to camp. First practice for the entire squad is at 9:30. Now, back to yesterday's scrimmage with the Cleveland Browns. Three things really sticking out. First, the quarterbacking of Matt Kofler. He was 12 of 19 and two touchdowns. And then the receiving of Ricky Mitchell Brookings. Four catches for 78 yards, including that 47-yard TD. And then the Bills' work of the defensive line. They had 15 sacks in all.
I like a number of them out there. As I stated, I think that there are a number of our people that have lived up to what we had hoped in the way of talent and athletic ability at this point. But we've still got a long way to go. A guy that we like today very much may not be in our plans at the end of preseason because he may not be able to sustain or we get a further evaluation and we may not be as high on that guy. So we've just taken one short step at this point.
Translating it means, what have you done for us lately? Okay, practice today up in Fredonia. No practice today up in Fredonia, but as we said, they'll resume tomorrow morning at 9:30. To baseball, where it's becoming obvious the Baltimore Orioles will not repeat as world champs. Today, the O's losing 8-4 in Kansas City. They now trail first place Detroit by 14 games. And where's the defense, boys? Eddie Murray will muff this one, and then Rich Dower gets into the act. He can't handle it. Meantime, a run scores, and the Royals lead 3-1. They strike again in the fifth. Greg Pryor with a looping single. Two runs will come across, making it 5-1. They go on to beat Baltimore 8-4. And you think the Orioles defense is bad? Check out the San Diego Chicken here. He'll pay for that blunder right there. Gotta move the glove every now and then. Let's go to the scoreboard. Elsewhere in the American League, the Yanks with a run in the bottom of the ninth edge Minnesota 6-5. Detroit wins for their ninth time in their last 10 games. Toronto scores five times in the fifth to beat Seattle. You saw the KC win over Baltimore 8-4. Bob Ojeda blanks California as the Red Sox win again. Dave Kingman, home run number 28, leading Oakland past Milwaukee. And Cleveland stops the White Sox 4-1. National League, Darryl Strawberry with the big hit as the Mets defeat Cincinnati 7-6. The Cubs lose, so New York now leads by 2.5 games. Steve Carlton with the pitching victory as Philadelphia wins at Atlanta. A 6-run seventh leads St. Louis over the Dodgers 7-6. San Diego and Pittsburgh split a doubleheader. The Pods take game one, but the Pirates come back in the nightcap winning 3-2, and tonight, Houston over Montreal 6-1. Meanwhile, the Bisons were beaten by one man this afternoon out at War Memorial Stadium. Number 16 right here, Todd Benzinger, had a season against Buffalo today. 2 homers, 7 RBIs as the Red Sox beat up on the Bisons 11-1. The only good thing about this one, the crowd, more than 5,000 showed up, but they went home dismayed, no doubt. The final once again 11-1 New Britain. The two teams will do it again tomorrow night at the stadium at 7 o'clock. Auto racing, Mario Andretti winning today's Michigan 500, but that was not the big story. Unfortunately, it was the pileups and injuries that got most of the attention.
33 cars lined up to start the annual Michigan 500, with Mario Andretti on the inside pole position, Tom Sneva right next to him. This race was marred by a number of yellow flags and accidents. On lap 148, the red car of Chip Ganassi spins out in the middle of the track and is hit by Al Unser Jr. The two cars tangle together and crash into the inside retaining wall. Ganassi suffered severe head injuries and possible fractured legs. On lap 216, Gary Bettenhausen in the green car is hit in the rear by Howdy Holmes. Bettenhausen flips over and the two cars, with Bettenhausen on the outside, ride up into the rail. Final lap of the race, Rick Mears and Pancho Carter battling for third place when Carter, trailing, hits the back of Mears and spins out, smashes into the retaining wall. The car totally disintegrates, drops down to the infield, and then turns over and over and over and over again. Miraculously, Carter escaped from the crash without serious injury. As the accident cleared, Mario Andretti captures the checkered flag to win the Michigan 500 by less than a car length over Tom Sneva. I'm Michael Stone for NBC News.
And quickly, Bev, Jimmy Arias was upset today at the quarterfinals of the U.S. Pro Tennis Championships by 16-year-old Aaron Krickstein.
Oh, my goodness. He'll spring back. He always does.
He will.
Okay. Thanks so much, Mike. Coming up from the News Center, the Duke has his day.
For disc brakes,
drum brakes,
any kind of brakes, who's got the best price?
Monroe Muffler Brake. Yay!
Wrist washer, you gotta have one. For good measure, or just for the pleasure. You're looking good like you knew.
Waste Watcher comes in 10 terrific flavors. Ask for the sugar-free soft drink with a tape measure label.
Ooh, you gotta have one, have one.
Halfway through the party, everyone ran out of things to say. Then at the stroke of midnight, someone appeared with the Sperry PC. It looked like most other personal computers, but it had a more comfortable keyboard. Dramatic color graphics, IBM software compatibility, and it ran 50% faster than the IBM PC. Now everyone had something to talk about again. The Sperry PC, what the personal computer should have been in the first place.